Hello, malty maltodextrins. I'm Ralphie. Welcome to Whisky Review 535 and a special malt mention credit, seeing as we've just had a malt mention, must go to Arthur in New York. Hello, Arthur in New York. I know you love New York. You told me so. Have a nice day now. And perhaps rather unusual whisky review. In fact, it's not a whisky review at all. Now, I hope I'm not presenting videos on YouTube under false pretenses. I do tend to review single malt Scotch whiskies, blended whiskies, rums, and I have reviewed some other spirits in the past, but I have never reviewed Grappa. Now, hold on a minute. Don't go away. Don't switch channels. Don't go and check your Facebook page again. Stay. I'll make it worth your while. I really will. I know it's not whiskey. You only want malt whiskey, some of you. It's got to be about the latest Lagavulin and the next special release, limited edition, doodad income, whatever finished. Pick your malt. Moment, but as our appreciation grows for single malt whisky, as we get to understand the arrival, the development and the finish, as we discover the evolving form in the glass that is a quality single malt whisky, it opens the gates for us. It gives us an atlas of the world. We can go around the world and we can discover other spirits, other places which bottle the provenance of their situation. And there's some very good examples of these spirits out there. Rum from Mauritius, another good example, Becherovka from Czech Republic. It's a lovely spirit, that. Again, it's a flavoured spirit, but a very good one. Mezcal, superb example. My favourite at the moment, from Chichicapa, a little village that produces this smoky mezcal-y stuff. Really enjoy that. And it's something that I do as a whisky drinker, and I want to share my journey with you so that you have a fuller journey yourself. Grappa. I first encountered Grappa really when I had a trip to Italy a number of years ago. I was wandering through Rome, as one does. I mean, there's certain cities in the world that are just so easy to walk. Paris, Rome, Florence, another good example, still in Italy. Granada in Spain, Havana in Cuba, Kyoto in Japan. These are just wonderful cities just to wander around until you just have to sit in a wall or a cafe somewhere because your feet are so sore from all the work walking. But you don't mind because it's such an enriching environment. And when I was in Rome, walking my feet red raw, I was going from the Piazza Verona down to the Fontana di Trevi, the Trevi Fountain, always worth a visit if you happen to be in Rome. And don't forget to throw your euro into the fountain and make your wish. And remember that wish was made in Rome, therefore it will work extra for you. It will, you know. And on that walk, I passed a Grappa shop, and what struck me was how ornate some of the bottles were. And of course, that put me off because I'm thinking all style and no substance. But I did try a few Grappas in Italy and I thoroughly enjoyed them. And again, if you're in Italy, don't go out buying fancy, expensive bottles of Italian wine. You'll probably find the best wine that you can get is the Vino di Tavola. The standard table wine, what families produce themselves from their own vineyards. It can be superb, juicy, fresh red wine. It really can. It's so easy to miss it if we tend to go into a new environment with our existing prejudices. Not malicious prejudices, just little prejudices which self-perpetuate, unaddressed, because they're relatively inoffensive until they are directly challenged. And it's when I bought a bottle of this, Nardini Reserva Grappa, that's when my prejudice as regards Grappa was well and truly challenged. This is a very good Grappa. To start with, it's bottled at 50% alcohol. It's this is a liter bottle. I got this at duty free. There's a certain amount of cask influence going on, but very minimal. But it's a superbly made, generic quality Grappa. Grappa, incidentally, if you do not know, is unlike brandy from France and Spain, where the juice of the grapes are then fermented, and instead of making wine, they are distilled into to brandy. And they use very dry, almost astringent grapes to produce the good brandy. But in Italy, very resourceful people. It's well seeing some of the most delicious food in the world comes from a country which has had so much poverty for so many people, and they've had to be very practical and use the simplest of recipes. And I love that interpretation of Italian food that goes like this. With French food, the chef's job is to present his skills. With Italian food, the chef's job is to present the divine nature of God, the freshness of the ingredients, and it's very, very much the case. And if you think you know pizza, you don't know pizza until you've been to the little back street cafes in Naples and tried some of their pizza, fresh out the wood-burning oven. Beautiful stuff, really is. But we are talking about Grappa, and I'm getting slightly distracted because I'm getting a bit nostalgic for my trips to Italy. As a whiskey drinker, I really enjoy the change. And the challenge for me is to suss out what's quality. Now, Grappa is made of the must or the leftover residue of winemaking. In other words, it's not the juice of the grapes which is first fermented, then distills. It is the leftovers, the skin, the pith, the pips, the pulp, the pumice of wine production. And it's a tremendous variety of flavours, as you can imagine, because there's quite a lot of grape varieties going on in Italy. And in fact, you'll find in certain areas that the distillation lorry is going around all the villages in the rural communities, and it'll stop in just off the high street in the town square, and the people will bring out their fermented pumice and have it distilled into their own house Grappa. Civilised country in that respect, in many ways. You know, it's trusting people to distill their own liquor, and as a matter of pride and dignity and self-respect within the community, the quality is there, absolutely. For a real malt fan, I recommend Reserva 15 Annie, 15-year-old cask-conditioned Grappa. It's a little bit expensive, and you can only get it in a 35-centilitre bottle, malt mates, but if you fancy yourself as a bit of a malt whisky fan, you really need to get a hold of a bottle of this. I'll briefly describe it for you. Again, this is bottled at 50% alcohol by volume. So essentially, it's 100 American proof. And soon as your nose hits the glass, soon as you make contact with the odours coming off this liquor, you know that you're not dealing with whiskey. No way. This is something altogether from a warmer, sunnier climate. There is a beautiful fresh fruit, slightly musty, hint of peach, a rich fructose aromatic spirit. Incidentally, this is matured very carefully in Slovenian oak casks for the full duration. of its maturation, and the balance and poise of the cask engagement in this grappa puts a lot of single malts totally to shame. Just saying. An enchanting, beautiful, lush, yes, that's a good word, lush, warm climate spirit. It has a certain kind of Indian Ocean rum nature to it. It's the nearest I can kind of find another spirit that kind of ties in with this. I would even mention Tasmanian whiskies like Sullivan's Cove. I can recognise that as a point of reference to this Nardini Reserva, but the most exquisite, soft spice, cinnamon, almost a hint of banana, but you're not quite sure. Cumin, delicate hint of cumin, honey, yes. So clean and so crisp and fresh for its 15 years. Exquisite arrival, understated, extensive complexity. It's not immediately transparent, but with whisky drinking experience, you can really pick up on the different form and structure of the spirit. And just how fantastic it is. It's a masterclass, actually, in the art of distillation. It really is. This is what you find in Italy. It's the home of the Ferrari, the Lamborghini, the Maserati, after all, of some exquisite fashion and enchanting, reasonably priced wines. And it's just understanding the Italian way. And when you visit Italy, you immerse yourself a little bit into the culture. You really understand what makes the place and the people tick. And to someone who spent all his life in Siberia by the sea, also known as Scotland, Italy can be, well, it is really quite exotic. And this is, I'm finding this quite nostalgic in this glass of grappa. When buying grappa, a lot of people's experiences of quite a coarse, rough spirit. And if it's the stuff that's just produced to be sold in the tourist shops, in Murano glass bottles with little glass grapes inside, that's what you're going to get. If you're buying grappa, do not buy grappa in tourist shops in Italy. Go to the specialist bottle shops. Or even better, ask an Italian. They'll know. There's almost a rich grain, toasted corn note to this, but it always remains with that fruit, little astringency and sharpness. Just remind you, it's not a grain, but it has the substance and character of an Irish corn whisky. Marks out of 100. Let me see for Reserva. There we go. 92 out of 100. And that is a grappa mark. I don't have a grappa card, so you'll have to trust me in that one. If you're in Italy, I recommend you try limoncello, very much an Italian alcoholic beverage. What you're looking for is a limoncello which is not bright yellow, that does not have colourant in it. You're looking for limoncello. Natural limoncello is slightly green and it is a pale yellow. It's almost a mustard, English mustard colour. If you're lucky, you will see oil from the lemons, lemon oil actually floating on the surface of the liquor, and it will be bottled at a minimum of 40%. When I was in Italy, I bought mine at Amalfi from the nun sitting on the step in front of the church. And it's the finest limoncello I have ever tasted in my life. I asked my friend Luigi, I said, Luigi, how come this limoncello is so fantastic? And I tasted others and they weren't quite so good, but this really stood out. And his answer was simple. The nuns always make the best limoncello. So now you know. Moving on to specialist, harder to get, but well worth looking for Italian grappa. This, as you can see by the imaginative and exquisite packaging, is, again, they are expensive, but you get what you pay for. And these are produced by Carlo Gobetti, who has a small family distillery just outside Verona. And absolutely typical of Italian grappa, you're really looking for small artisan craft producers that don't market, that don't advertise. So you need to speak to someone who's a grappa enthusiast. And that's when you'll get put in touch as to where you can buy bottles like this. You know, Carlo Gobetti, in my opinion, is not just one of the finest grappa distillers in Italy. He is, in fact, one of the greatest contemporary spirit producers in the world. This particular bottle, no label on the bottle. Excellent packaging, simplistic, understated, and completely lacking in bullshitty pretension. It's original and authentic, and we like that. And the label on the outside gives the provenance of what's in the bottle. This is single estate grappa. It is produced from materia prima, which is the pumice. There's Vinaccia di Amarone, and the Provenienza is Lonardi, Valgattara, Verona. And it's distilled in Maggio 1995 and imbottigliata il 31st August 2005. So essentially this has been resting for 10 years. And it shows. It shows in what you're tasting. This is bottle 184 of 324 bottles, and it's signed by the distiller. Now, this is a sign of true artisan provenance. Now, I could pour one or the other. I think I'll just pour both, because they taste so completely different. When you visit Carlo Gobetti's distillery website, just Google it, you'll soon find it. You see what looks like a traditional domestic copper immersion heater, boiler, for heating your bath water. That's what it still looks like. It's a fractional, basic, old school still that really works a treat. So here we have in the squat bottle, we have Amarone. And in the tall bottle, we have this phenomenal confection of violets that is Moscato. There we go. Uva di Moscato di Amburgo. Lovely. It takes a bit of time to get your nose round the sheer confusing complexity of a serious grade grappa. It's phenomenal. There's a musty rosewater smell, slight Turkish delight, lemongrass, coriander, lime juice, mushrooms. Not, yeah, mushrooms. There's a savoury note in here. Violets. Brûlée. Aubergines. Avocado. Don't ask. Bottled at, give me a second, 57% alcohol. But don't add too much water. Within a few minutes, you'll start to see a cloudiness appear. The natural oils from the ferment coming through the still. No colour added, no chill filtration, no mucking things up, as it should be. You add a drop more water, start to get more herbal notes. Spearmint, most definitely. Spearmint. Aromint. Eucalyptus oil. The list goes on. The taste, the length of the arrival is continuing even as I'm talking. Now we're into the development. Development actually changes. It's literally changing direction at the moment of development. Astringent, minty, dry mint. Very drying, slightly salty. And the finish, a little rich, intense vanilla oils. And again, spearmint. Burnt, hints of burnt licorice. Fantastically interesting. And so many Scotch whisky drinkers wouldn't touch Grappa with a barge pole, and as a result are missing out on a really good experience. And you take what we learn from tasting Grappas and brandies and rums, and we bring it back to whisky, Scotch whisky, and it really helps us to pin down the good stuff and the not so good stuff. Quality, no matter what the product, is always a very solid reference in its own right. Here, the Moscato is phenomenally aromatic. It's got this wonderful ice cream fruit. Now, ice cream fruit, tropical rainforest, great big pear-shaped thing with a massive stone in it and some fluffy white fruit pulp inside. It's called the, it's not snow fruit, ice cream fruit. Get a strong odour of that. And the violets, the most exquisite rainbow of violet notes. Delicate vanilla. Spearmint. Parsley. Rosemary. Thyme. And something, again, something savoury. The volume of flavour that's coming off the nose all at once is something you really don't encounter too often in whisky. Whisky tends to deliver in instalments, whereas this top quality Grappa is just an explosion of the energy from which the spirit was sourced. I'm even starting to sound Italian now in my interpretation of the experience. That's just for the Moscato. 95 out of 100. for my Grappa mark. This is why I say that Carlo Gobetti is not just one of the greatest distillers in Italy. He's one of the greatest distillers in the world of any spirit. And he's not alone. There are other little family, Italian family Grappa producers who we just can't get hold of what they produce until we visit Italy. But if you do go to Italy, look out for these, because they are truly amazing spirits. I would conclude by saying that it's well documented that a previous senior manager within the Scotch whisky industry met some Grappa producers who were over to learn a bit about Scotch whisky. And it's now quite a famous story, which has done its rounds of the malt circuit. This man's attitude and manner were extremely poor. Some would say belligerent and denigrating as to Grappa in comparison to Scotch whisky. And as they say, in the heart of arrogance is the first step of downfall. And it was ironically when I heard that story that I made a note in my travel pad that as soon as I got to Italy, I would look out for some Grappas and I would check them out. And do you know what? Oh boy. And whether it was Florence, Venice or Rome, I never had a sober night. Anyway, we'll leave it at that. Whisky review concluded. I hope that my enthusiasm restrained northern Scandinavian style enthusiasm has rubbed off a little bit, malt mates, to broaden your horizons and to put more colours on the palette of your paintbrush so that the canvas of your liquor experience holds more depth and character all round. I'm Ralphie. I've just finished a whisky review, which wasn't a whisky review. It was a review about Grappa. I'm glad I... Oh, boy. Excuse me. I'm just going to give this little bottle a great big Italian hug. A Scottish-Italian hug. And this is the 92 out of 100. It's seriously good stuff.